Good morning. Welcome to worship today on this Labor Day weekend, where people are eking the last little bit of summer out of, like, wringing the last little bit of summer. I don't know if you have seen the forecast, but it's supposed to be very, very hot today, very, very hot tomorrow. So we'll see how that ringing of the summer goes. And then, I don't know, after that, it starts to cool down. We thought we were into fall, didn't we? School started, cool weather. And here we are with some sort of an Indian summer. Anyway, welcome to worship this morning. I have good news about the wireless mic situation that I want to update you on. We have placed an order for 4 new wireless mics. I'm going to have a headset that we have asked to have delivered by the 15th of September. So, but until then, I'm going to use this or a handheld when I'm beyond the table or down here. So, bear with us, please. I just decided I didn't want to be working with something that was going to be hard for you to hear, right? So again, welcome to worship, and I'm going to invite you to join me in prayer, and then I'll go light the Christ candle and we'll listen to the prelude. But I do invite you, as you have entered into this space, to be mindful of those who are with you, mindful of those who are sitting next to you, down the pew from you, aware of one another. You know, we all bring a variety of things with us on our hearts when we come into church. Church means different things to different people. So as we gather our hearts together in this time and in this sacred place, may we be mindful of one another as we prepare to sense the deep presence of God. Please join me in prayer. Gracious and loving God, as the light shines into this space, we pray for the light to shine into our hearts. You are the one who knows all that we hold in our hearts. You know the joys, you know the heaviness. You feel with us, and we are grateful that you walk alongside us. Shine your light upon us, through us, among us this day, we pray. Amen.
Good morning. Welcome. My name is Jim Hammond. I am your lay reader today. You might have guessed that.
Looks it's not showing on that back screen. It's not showing on the back screen.
We could improvise. Okay.
Hey, let's hear it for George. Thank
you. All right. I lift my voice to you, O Lord.
To you I plead for mercy.
I pour out my lament before you.
Tell you about my troubles.
Even when my strength leaves me,
watch my footsteps.
I cry out to you, O Lord.
I'll invite you to turn to hymn number 339 and rise in body or spirit as we sing, lift every voice and sing. I said this morning to Phil, I have chosen a big, big hymn, and we are few in number, but we will be mighty in voice, yes? So we will fill this space from floor to rafter as we sing together, lift every voice and sing, let's rise together.
Thank you.
to thank you for playing the last verse in that traditional, majestic way. Oh, and thank you all for giving that your best voice. Welcome again to our worship service this morning on this Labor Day weekend. I talked to a few parents who have said it's hard now when school starts before Labor Day. It's hard to start and then stop. I don't know if that's been the experience of some of you who have kids in your home or are teaching, but the starting and stopping, the structure, the non-structure, is bearing heavily on some of our parents and probably our teachers too. Next week, we are commissioning our teachers and our administrators, blessing the shoes that our children will be wearing into the places that they'll go this year. So look forward to that next Sunday. We also start our fall program year next Sunday. So we start with singing choir next Sunday. We start with our education classes. Our adult education class starts at 9 o'clock on Sunday. So you'll hear more about that later in the worship service as well. I welcome you who are joining us on Zoom. It's good to have you with us. And also, if you're joining us by YouTube, it's good to have you with us as a part of our worshiping community as well. I invite you to take the pad at the end of the pew, write your name, and pass it on down. And during this time of writing and passing and noting each other, let's pass the peace with each other as well. The peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Please turn to one another and offer the peace of Christ to each other. I also would like the children to come and meet me on the steps. Whoever we have this morning, we have Maggie. Come on, Penny, you come with me. You guys come on up. Carson, come on up. Nolan? Come on up. He's busy writing. I know, writing, passing, moving, whatever. Okay, we're gonna come back right up here. We're gonna come back around to teaching the signs of our mission statement. So if you've been with me, you're gonna kind of help me model for the people in the congregation what they're gonna do, okay, on this. And if you're just learning with me, then we're gonna do this together. But I gotta set this microphone down because I need both my hands. And we need the mission statement up here so we can see the words, and then we'll know what words we're gonna do signs for, right? This is the last of 4 weeks of preaching on the four phrases in the middle of our mission statement. I'm gonna put this down.
Community, right to the left side, community, like you're pressing together, all the way across your heart. on, but oh, there's my voice. Good morning, everybody. I'm going to take this opportunity to make a very shameless plug about choir that is returning in the coming week. Thursday evening, we will start with a 6 o'clock potluck and then 7 o'clock rehearsal. I invite any and all of you to join. Seriously, I hear the words all the time, oh, you don't want to hear me sing. Yes, I do. I do want to hear you sing. I really do. I invite anybody who has, you know, any inkling that they might want to sing in the choir to give it a try. At least come to a rehearsal. Why not see what it's like for you? And then, you know, if you want to do that more often, great. However, you know, if we're taking a Sunday morning and talking about the voice, I have to use my left hand while I'm, I could switch it, okay. You know, just because it happens to fall on Labor Day weekend that we're talking about voices and choir starts next week, we can't wait until next week to have a choir. We need to have a choir today, everybody. So I'm going to ask people to hop on up here. I promise you know the song. I promise you do. I have sheet music for you. It's just a hymn that you know. Come on up. I see faces. Will, good sir, come on. Yeah, let's come on over here. Yes. Oh, Mary Beth is here. I didn't even see you. Come on. Come on. Penny, come on. If you have ever sung in a choir, if you have ever thought about singing in a choir, this is an invitation to you to come on up to. Come on around, yes.
We're going to continue now with our worship service with our offering. We just get an offering of our voices, and we'll now do an offering of our resources and our gifts to share. Remember, we've been doing this two-sided page, a couple pages stapled together of the ways we would like to connect in community and offer ourselves. If you've not yet turned this in, please do in the offering plate, and we are collecting these, and Craig's helping us organize these to bring people together to serve together in teams. I also want to introduce this morning the Peace and Global Witness offering. This is one of our denominational offerings. It goes from today until World Communion Sunday, which is October 1st. The Peace and Global Witness offering is just kind of as it sounds. It's about peacemaking around the world. But we do have an opportunity to retain 25% of this offering for use in the community. And we have identified that we want this to go to mental health in our community, particularly mental health for people who've been struggling with addictions. And I think, Doug, the organization Pathways is the organization that we're going to be working with in Adrian. So here's the challenge I'll give to you. Last year in this offering, we raised $1,141. I'm wondering if we could raise $1,500 this year for this, retaining 25% for people who are struggling with mental health and addictions. And I wonder if we broke that down, that would be, I think if my math is correct on this, 30 people at $50 each. Right, it'd be 15 people at $100 each. But here's what I really want to compel you to think about. Addiction is so pervasive that I'm going to guess that we all know someone who struggles with this. Maybe more than one someone. And maybe it's someone close to us. And so what if we gave an offering to this in honor of that person? Just something to think about. So we're introducing it today. It's going to go throughout the month of September. And you know, if you're in touch with me, Doug, I can tell people how we're doing with regard to the goal. Right? Okay. All right. Let's move forward with our offering, our daily offering. And we'll go right into 606, Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Please join me in prayer. Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, we are honored to be able to give from ourselves, give from the skills that you've endowed upon us, give to the healing of others, the peace of others, the joy of others. It is a blessing to give, and we are grateful. And we ask that you would take these offerings that we give, the offerings of our resources, the offerings of ourselves, the offerings of our prayer shawls, and that you will indeed make them instruments of grace to a world in need of grace. In Christ we pray, amen. Please be seated. Throughout the month of August, we've been singing a song to prepare us for the hearing of the word. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet. It's number 458, but the words also will be projected on the screen. And I'm going to just encourage you to let the melody fill your heart as well as the words as we sing together, Thy word is a lamp unto my feet.
The scripture this morning, it comes from 1 Samuel, and this is a story about Hannah, the wife of Elkanah. Hannah could not have children, and this made her life very difficult. One year, she traveled with her husband to the temple. After dinner, Hannah went to the temple and knelt outside of it to pray. Now Eli the priest was sitting on the seat beside the doorstep of the temple of the Lord. Hannah was deeply distressed and prayed to the Lord and wept bitterly. She made this vow, O Lord of hosts, if only you will look on my misery of your servant and remember me and not forget your servant. But I will give you, your servant, a male child. Then I will set him before you as a Nazirite until the day of his death. As she continued praying before the Lord, Eli observed her mouth. Anna was praying silently. Only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore, Eli thought she was drunk. So Eli said to her, How long will you make a drunken spectacle of yourself? Put away that wine. But Hannah answered, No, my Lord, I am a woman deeply troubled. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but I have been pouring out my soul before the Lord. Do not regard your servant as a worthless woman, for I have been speaking out of my great anxiety and vexation all this time.
A reading from the Gospel of Mark. This is coming from the 10th chapter, verses 46 to 52. As Jesus and his disciples and a large crowd were leaving Jericho, Bartimaeus, son of Timaeus, a blind beggar, was sitting by the roadside. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout out and say, Many sternly ordered him to be quiet, but he cried out even more loudly, Jesus stood still and said, call him here. And they called the blind man, saying to him, take heart, get up, he's calling you. So throwing off his cloak, Bartimaeus sprang up and came to Jesus. Then Jesus said to him, what do you want me to do for you? The blind man said to him, Jesus said to him, go, your faith has made you well. Immediately, he regained his sight and followed him on the way. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. We are a loving community of faith, following Jesus Christ, where everyone has a place, a face, a story, and a voice. A voice. What does it mean to say in our church mission statement that everyone has a voice? Well, I'm going to start with singing. We're singing a lot this morning. Sing a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. In Psalms, we read this over and over again. Sing a new song to the Lord. Psalms is a book of prayers, but it's a songbook. It's like a hymnal of prayers, because people of faith throughout the entire history of faith sang their faith across the globe. They lifted their voices and sang. All God's creatures got a place in the choir. Some sing low, some sing higher, some sing out loud on the telephone wire. Some just clap their hands or pause or anything they got now, right? Beethoven says music is the language of God. And John Bell says God has given everyone a voice, an instrument. Singing is a natural thing. So we sing together in church. Everybody has a voice. But I'm going to tell you, from where I stand, I know that not everybody sings. In his book, The Singing Thing, John Bell says, one out of every four people believe they can't sing. And when he asks people why they believe that, almost everybody says, somebody told me. And you know that that somebody is almost always someone who is important to the person, like a family member or an intimate partner, maybe a teacher, a friend. But interestingly, John Bell says that this is not an issue in other continents. Across the globe, singing is a part of everyday life. There's a presumption that everybody sings, and everybody sings. It's the not singing that's the outlier, and it's, he says, a uniquely Western European thing. There are a small percentage of people for whom physiological issues actually make it difficult to sing. But for the majority, Bell says, it's actually specific memories that prevent us from letting our voices free. And I've talked about this with people, and some have told me they know exactly the time, they know exactly the place that they were told they couldn't sing, and they stopped singing. In his book, Bell tells about Margaret, whose mother told her, Margaret, God wants you to praise him with your heart and your voice, and I think he'd be better pleased if you just used your heart. And that day, she stopped singing. And Dennis, who had a crush on a girl when he was 18, and he liked her so much that he wanted to go to church with her. And so he went to church with her, and after church, she said to him, if we go back to church together, would you mind not singing so loudly? Because it's just not very tuneful. Sometimes these stories go back to our childhood, and they hold our voices ransom for decades. The remedy, says John Bell, is to make a theological choice. Listen to this. Whose voice will you listen to? The one who locked up your voice, or who one who wants to set it free? Listen to the one who gave you the instrument, the one who says to you, sing me a new song. Now, some say, I don't read music, I don't know the tune. And to that, John Bell says, trust muscle memory. That's what he says, trust muscle memory. Listen with your ears to the tune, and then trust and let go. Don't fear. Everybody makes mistakes, especially when we're learning something new. Maybe you'll get it on the next verse, or maybe you'll get it on the next verse, or maybe you'll get it the next time we sing it. But try. Some say, I can't read the words in the hymnal, so now we're projecting them bigger on the screen. We sing together in church. Why? It's a way of expressing a common story. It's a way of joining our hearts. It's a way of more deeply feeling the emotion of the words that we put forward. We sing in solidarity. We sing in fervent hope for a new day. Everyone has a voice. So join the song. Now, what does it mean to say everyone has a voice when it comes to praying in church? Well, sometimes we do unison prayers. Like just in a few minutes, we'll say the Lord's Prayer together, an ancient prayer. When each one of us joins our voices to that prayer, we're joining generations and generations of people across the globe who have said these words, these same words in different languages, hundreds and thousands of languages. So we're part of a big, big, big global family of faith when we use our voices and join others in a unison prayer. Sometimes we pray in unison our prayers of confession, and we're confessing the sins of the world, belief in a better way, a better world, a fairer world, a truer life together. What about our joys and concerns? What about our joys and concerns? That's this time in our church service where individuals raise their hands and then raise their voices to ask for prayer. This is a really sacred time here. It's a holy time. We listen to each other's voices, and sometimes we can hear the emotion in the voice. Sometimes we can hear the grief. We can hear the fear, the vulnerability, the relief sometimes. I think when we're doing this, we're giving voice to our humanity, to what we're walking through, that we're asking for others to walk with us. We're also seeking empathy for people outside of this room, neighbors, friends, people who are struggling beyond us. Sometimes it's a world crisis we're lifting our voices to. But you know what? This time in our service, it's a wild card, isn't it? Really. Sometimes there's nothing that's raised. I mean, no one speaks. Sometimes it can go on for like 15, 20 minutes, right? Some people have suggested to me that we set a time limit for this. And others have suggested maybe I write a script to give to people when they're going to share their concerns. Some worry about visitors who might come and that they might feel awkward because they don't know the people that are being talked about. Folks, this is a tender time. And to censor it feels a little to me like Eli with Hannah, a little like the disciples with Bartimaeus. Eli felt so uncomfortable watching her move her lips with nothing coming out that he tried to silence her silent prayer. And Jesus leaned into the one that the disciples were trying to shut down. When we're sharing these joys and concerns, we're asking people to pray with us. This is a time to be charitable and generous to each other, toward each other, and it's an invitation to see each other, and to walk alongside each other with grace. Now, I know this too. Everyone is not comfortable speaking out loud. I do know that. And that does not mean that they do not yearn for our prayers. So what I would like to do is insert a time of silence at the beginning of our joys and concerns, where we just sit together, opening our hearts to each other. The joys and concerns is not, there should be no privilege of one voice over another in that time. Even the ones who aren't raising their voices, the ones who are sitting in silence. So how might we tune our ears and our hearts to listen to that? This is a time, a space we hold open. It's holy, and it's sacred, and it's free. So what does it say, what does it mean to say everyone has a voice in Bible studies and classes? And we come into this space, and we're all wrestling with our own thoughts about the Bible itself, maybe, about the text before us. We have questions, we have ever-evolving questions, and doubts, and confusion, and every voice is welcome in that space. Whether you've never opened a Bible before, ever, or you've been a lifelong Bible student, you're welcome in that space. We make room for each other and our myriad wanderings, because I will tell you, that's where the Spirit is. We all bring different life experiences and insights to this sacred ancient text, and we bring a host of emotions and memories. Some people bring trauma and fear. Some bring comfort and hope, anger and doubt and wonder and awe. It's all in the room when we open up this book together. This good book elicits this wide variety of responses, and the Holy Spirit moves among us and through us and weaves our conversations, our stories together, our voices together into something new. Everyone has a voice. Now, some are quick responders. I'm one. And some need some time. They need a little time. A question's posed to the group. They need a little time to think and reflect before they speak. And the quick responders, you know, we can crowd out that space. Susan Cain wrote a book called Quiet, The Power of Introverts in a World That Can't Stop Talking. And Susan Cain reminds us, there is zero correlation between being the best talker and having the best ideas. So the challenge for us is to moderate ourselves in groups so that everyone feels welcome to share. Now, what about leadership and decision-making in the church? Everyone has a voice. It's a reminder to us and to the leadership of this church to listen to all voices and to make every effort to ensure they feel heard, which is not the same thing as ensuring a suggestion will be adopted. How can your voice be heard by the 9 elders that comprise the session whose pictures are on this board out here? What's the best way to share an idea for new ministry or a suggestion? I have a couple thoughts. The first one is to please speak for yourself. When we say everyone has a voice, that means everyone has a voice. and it has been not the best strategy to speak for someone else. Sometimes that actually causes some hurt. So let everyone raise their own voice. The second suggestion is leave a paper trail. I will be the first to admit that I may not remember a conversation that we have verbally before church on a Sunday morning. And if you see an elder or me in the grocery store or on the golf course or here at church and you share something with us, please follow it up with an email. And if you want the message to go to the whole of session, write an email to Harvey Schmidt. He's our clerk. And at every session meeting, he reads official correspondence he's received, and we respond. It is ultimately the call of the nine elders of this church to discern the voice of God, to seek a way forward that honors all and not only some, and that prioritizes ministry and spending in order to build up the body, to engage the community beyond these walls, and to care for this facility. That's a lot. That's why we lay hands on each one, and that's why we call upon the Holy Spirit to equip us for the work we do. We are a loving community of faith, following Jesus Christ, where everyone has a place, a face, a story, and a voice. Our minds, our hearts, and hands are engaged as we humbly serve our neighbors near and far. Come and see. That's our whole mission statement. And it's an aspirational vision. We're not there. Maybe we never will be there. Someone suggested to me about a year ago, we shouldn't even have some of these statements in here because no organization can be this. Shouldn't we always aspire? By God's grace, may we live into this together. We're going to move into a time of sharing of our joys and concerns. And I'm going to suggest we do it a little bit differently this morning. I'd like to start with verse 1 of hymn number 471, O Lord, hear my prayer. And then I won't speak in between any of the joys and concerns that are shared. We'll finish that section of sharing with verse 2. But before we start with any verbal sharing, after we sing verse 1, let's hold some silence and just be mindful that there may be some among us who won't speak, won't actually lift their voices, but are deeply in need of prayer. So let's sing together, O Lord, hear my prayer, verse 1. Let's open up for lifting up of voices in the sharing of joys and concerns. I don't know. Okay, we have a microphone right here for somebody who might want to take it around. Maggie? Here she comes. So if you would raise your hand if you have a joy or concern to share, and Maggie will bring you the microphone. I'll just, while she's moving, I'll just tell you, Carol Lou Weaver is in a rehab center. She's in the Lenawee Medical Facility, Medical Center, and she is blooming where she's planted. She's wheeling herself around to different hallways and praying with people who are there. This is not surprising to you who know her. She called me to ask me for prayers for a friend she's met named Ron, who is very discouraged. And I told her that we would pray for Ron. We'll also pray for Carol Lou as well.
Hi, I'm Judy. I just wanted to add a PS to what she said about Carol Lou. I had a lovely conversation with Carol Lou yesterday. She loves phone calls. If you get a moment, she's in her wheelchair, working up her arm strength because she can't put any weight on her foot for at least 4 weeks. And she's going in almost every room, knocking on doors, asking, can I come in? And this gentleman, Ron, she asked him one day, may I pray with you? And he said, yes. And he's Catholic, and they are having a great time. She's taking our church. Though she can't walk, she's walking it.
Hi, my name is Luann, and I ask for prayers for me. Today would be my husband's 85th birthday, so I'm remembering him. I'm sure he's 80, would be 85 today, and he would have been a very handsome 85-year-old. Thank you.
This is Dennis Bowman. Last week, I asked for prayers for my friend Bob Michalak, who was at the University of Michigan Medical System. And it was suggested to me that I take prayer shawl to him. Well, I took two. And Bob had tears in his eyes when I presented those to him and told him that this was our way of bringing our love and the power of God's healing to him through these articles. And I'm happy to say that Bob has made a lot of progress and has been released from the hospital under, you know, very careful medical follow-up. But when you're not in the hospital, that's an improvement. So, and he asked me to give his thanks to the congregation for praying for him and for the gift of the prayer shawls.
Good morning, my name is Asia Andre. I'd like to announce that after 4 days of tryouts, Penelope has made her middle school volleyball team, and she's very excited to be trying that out. Thank you.
As for travel mercies for Rochelle, our daughter Kim, Nancy, and Pam, are on the road to walk the bridge tomorrow up at Mackinac, and then they'll be at the north end. They're going over to Mackinac Island because two of them have never been to Mackinac Island. And so it's quite the adventure, and it all fit in the back of Rochelle's Edge this morning. So
you, I'm Larry Jacobson. The campaign that I began to assist the Kenyan pastor, you know, acquire funds to pay for the paperwork and, you know, to acquire permanent residency green cards for his family. The campaign goes on. I would like to indicate that the paperwork is estimated to cost maybe $1,000 per family member. So far, the GoFundMe that I'm running has raised about enough to pay for one of the five of them. Cheryl and I visited them a few weeks ago. We had never met the family before, and we were just charmed by them. Pastor Douglas and his wife Evelyn are the same age as my kids. His kids are 15, 12, and 8. Like I said before, had they stayed here in Tecumseh, I had planned to be a spare grandpa to them. And I still try that, even though they're about as far north as Chicago is west. But it's a worthwhile thing. It will enhance their security. It will allow his wife Evelyn and his son to work, and that's about it. Thank you for your time.
I'm Louise Solomon, and we found out on Friday that indeed my son has prostate cancer. We don't know how bad, you know, we don't know to what degree. They're working things up, I would very much appreciate prayers.
Anybody else? Okay, let's move into verse 2 then. O Lord, hear my prayer. Ask for that microphone that was just being passed around for me to use it behind the table, because the one I have has some interference with it. So can somebody, Maggie, could you run that one up to me? And it will not come as a surprise to you all to hear me say that sometimes I fantasize about actually being a pastor in the times when church met in the catacombs and just had candles and no technology. As much as I know it's helpful to us, I do sometimes, thank you, dream of that day. Let's join together at the table. This is the table of our Lord. This is the table of grace. This is the table of love. This is the table of peace. This is the table of joy. This is the table of hope. When I first came to this church, the very first thing I saw when I walked into the sanctuary was this wood carving behind me. And I thought, this is a church that places the table in the center of their life together. Theologically, I thought that this being that symbol, that big symbol in the front of the church, says, this is the table of the Lord. And in that front of that table scene, in that front of that wood carving, there's an empty space, and that's for each one of you to be welcome to the table. And indeed we are. Not by anything that we've done, but by God's grace. We all are welcome to this table. Please join me in prayer. We thank you, O great and gracious God, for your voice which brings forth life, your voice which resounds throughout creation, your voice spoken through the prophets, exposing hypocrisies, revealing truth. Your voice spoken through Jesus, healing the sick, welcoming strangers, honoring all. Your voice that welcomes us home. May we at this table be fed by your grace. May we at this table encounter each other anew in your love. May we at this table experience genuine community. We offer these ordinary gifts of bread and fruit of the vine to be transformed by your Spirit, becoming the body of Christ for the body of Christ, and the cup of forgiveness, new life for all. Hear us now as we, your family, join our voices to generations and generations who pray the prayer taught to us by our Savior Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, I want us to remember when we come to this table, we are remembering Jesus. Do this in remembrance of me, he says. We remember when we break the bread that he said to those gathered around the table, this is my body broken for you. And we remember when we share in the cup that he said, this cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood for the forgiveness of sin. So when we come to this table and we share in this bread and we share in this cup, we remember him and the fullness of who he is and is to be. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And this is all gluten-free bread. You are invited to come forward and take a piece of the bread and turn to either side and dip it into the cup of juice before returning. Why don't we sing as we feel moved, as we come forward? We'll sing hymn number 525, but we'll project it. Let us break bread together on our knees. Please join me in prayer. For all that you are and all that you call us to be, we give you thanks. And now, having been fed at your table, may we rise to feed a hungering world with your grace, your mercy, your compassion, your love, and your promise of new life. Let it be so, we pray. Amen. We have a space reserved at the end of our worship services for a minute from the deacons. It looks like it's going to be Judy this morning. Judy, if you could make your way to the microphone. You all could turn that microphone on to be ready for Judy when she gets there. And then while she's making her way, if you could be ready to sing hymn number 305, which is our closing hymn, Come Sing, O Church, in Joy. Judy.
My name is Judy. I'm singing to you today. Two things. Photos for the directory are going to be taken until the end of the month. The second thing, we will be delivering our contributions to the migrant workers in 2 weeks. We hope to assemble the gift packages ourselves with the nuns in Adrian. I spoke to Nun Nancy, Sister Nancy, who said they would love to have additionally wrapped candies to put in their pockets to take to the fields, or peanut butter crackers that are in little packages. They would love their own new bed pillow and washcloths and hand towels. The collection's in the hall, and you can see already so many beautiful things have been given. Even if you could just bring an empty laundry basket, because that's what we pack for them. God bless you all.
I do just want to remind you that next week we start our fall program year. 9 o'clock is adult education, 10:30 is our worship, and the children's classes begin next week as well. We are still looking for volunteers to help out with the children's education programming. We would like to staff the ARC continuing into the fall for our youngest disciples. So if you'd like to serve in the ARC, that is on the sign up now as well for volunteers. We have the Rainbow Room and Grotto as well. So that's an online sign up. And I'm speaking on behalf of Sam to encourage you, please, either to let her know after church if you'd like to sign up, or go online and sign up for that as well. Next week also, we have a cookie and brownie potluck. So we have refined this. Instead of being all kinds of desserts, cookies and brownies. For this reason, what we don't eat next Sunday can be easily frozen for future coffee hours or for the Presbytery meeting where we're also doing cookies and brownies. So bake away favorite recipes, maybe bring it to share as well, cookies and brownies next Sunday after church, and we'll do a blessing of the shoes and a commissioning of teachers. And we go forth now from this place, having been fed, having been nourished in the company of our living God as well as one another, to be a voice of change, be a voice of love, be a voice of hope, a voice of encouragement, with whomever crosses our path this day. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Could be. I can do things like that.
Thank you.